Hey, how's it going, guys? Mr. Boss for the win here, and in today's Red Dead Redemption 2 video, we're going to be talking about the dark and creepy secrets of the serial killer that you just don't know about. So this is one of the first couple of Red Dead Redemption 2 videos that I uploaded because I accidentally stumbled upon one of the first clues to actually solve this serial killer mystery. And in case you have no idea what I'm talking about, there are three clues scattered throughout the world of Red Dead Redemption 2, all that sort of give off a very serial killer murder mystery vibe. The first can actually be found incredibly close to Valentine, and all have a very similar theme of like dismembered body parts, you know, hanging bodies from, you know, structures. There's going to be a set of words or a phrase that also appears by the body as well. At this first location, you have "look on my works," which, by the way, I still haven't figured out what these mean. At the end of the video, I try and, you know, insert them as cheat codes, but they don't work. We'll talk about that at the end. And at each location, there is always a severed head with a clue that you can find that sort of will tell us where to go at the very end. So it doesn't matter in what order you collect these clues in. This is the first clue right here. You can see that it's like a bridge leading to something, and that's just about it. Maybe into the woods. That's all we can really gather. And as you can see, it is located at this location right here, like literally just southeast of Valentine. The next location is pretty close to Valentine as well. And basically what you want to do is just follow this path. You will find a scrap heap of body parts and blood that sort of lead to this field with three big rocks. And once again, you get the exact same thing here. You have a dismembered body part that is tied up. This one says, "Do you see?" question mark. Again, I'm not too sure what that means. And right next to it as well, you can find another dismembered head. And this will give us our second clue. And this sort of completes the bridge from the first scene. And it also sort of gives us maybe like a half-finished building with like a chimney as part two. So that's the second clue right there. It is located just to the south of Wallace Station. So those two are really close together in terms of being able to grab them back to back. And our third location today is the furthest away. It's south of Rhodes. We'll take a look at the exact location in a bit. And basically off to the right of this path, you're going to want to look for the same thing, more body parts on the ground, blood. And there's like this big tree with giant roots sticking out of the ground. And on one of the roots, it says, "Behold." So if we piece together all three of those, "look on my works," "do you see?" "behold." I'm really not too sure what that's supposed to mean. Maybe you guys can let me know in the comments down below. Same thing here, you know, more of the hanging body, and you can find the severed head at the back. And this is our third and final clue. And you can see this time it looks like it's pointing towards a cellar, and it has the combination code on what looks to be a lock, 63432. Now, once you've collected that third and final clue, it will piece together the entire map. And it says, "all three pieces of the map have been collected. Use the map to locate the killer's hiding place." And you can see it tells us to go over a bridge and through the woods to this like abandoned cabin with a cellar. And we know the combination code. And now we have to go to the location of the serial killer, which is going to be just to the west of Valentine at this place called Lucky's Cabin. So when you get close, you'll know you're at the right place when you see a giant white question mark on the map, and then it will actually prompt you to open up the cellar door, which you can. Now, I highly recommend that if you want to explore this and the secrets of this place, that you bring a lantern. Otherwise, you are just not going to be able to see. So upon immediately entering, you're going to notice a ton of more like skulls and body parts and blood and handprints and, you know, dismembered things. And we can actually get some interesting information from these notes on the wall. Now, from what I've gathered, these are newspaper clippings of his past murders. So this guy has sort of kept a shrine of like the old media accounts of, you know, things that he has done, which is pretty crazy. There's one in particular that's very creepy. It actually happened in Blackwater, the Montana River Mystery. February 9th is my birthday, so that's kind of crazy. And it tells you about the murders, how like all the ribs on the body were broken, how it was totally mutilated. The head had been cut first with a knife and then the face hacked with a cleaver. Like, just gruesome murders that this guy ultimately does. Now, there's also two notes that you can directly interact with as well that give us more detail. It seems this guy is feeding the media its own sort of like paranoia. So there's a letter that says, letter to the editor. Dear Mr. Editor, I must say I am alarmed by the paucity of coverage your August journal has dedicated to the recent killings in the region. The perpetrator of these crimes is clearly a man of great intelligence, power, and no small amount of cunning. He presents a clear and present danger to all readers of your publication, and most probably to the writers of it as well. I would suggest you begin to treat him and his creations with the reverence that they deserve. God help us all. Yours, a concerned citizen. So this guy is like feeding the fire to his own murders, which is insane. And you can also see that he has a letter from his mother. Letter to Edmund from mother. My dear Edmund, what has gotten into you of late? Our dinners together, which were such a pleasure to me, have become a terrible strain. You appear at times tired, distracted, feeble, and agitated, and sometimes all those things at once. It was a mistake for you to have ever moved out of home. While I approved of your decision to forgo marriage in order to spend more time with me, I did not envision it would be this kind of company. Maybe a wife is what you need after all. Your kindly neighbors inform me of your comings and goings from your rooms at all hours of the night. Does this mean there's a close friendship your mother doesn't know about? I hope your taste and companionship has improved these past years, but I shall keep an open mind. I should like an explanation of all this from you presently, your loving and concerned mother. P.S. I hope you're eating and sleeping and taking the Landinum Dr. Finkels gave you. That should improve your nerves. So we can clearly see that this guy has some neurotic behavior, and apparently he's supposed to be taking medicine for it as well. Now, you can continue to explore the area and you'll find a bunch of creepy stuff, missing posters for like girls, body parts. And if you go around the corner, you'll find even more stuff. This guy's got like a camera all set up. He's got like whole bodies that he's like ripped open. It's insane. And you'll notice that you're supposed to interact with a knife on the ground. And if you do that, it'll actually trigger this cutscene.
Have you come for me? Or was this all nasty surprise? Or maybe it's both. Maybe it is a nasty surprise, even though you knew I was going to be here. Which is it? You should think about that. Save yourself thinking about what's about to happen. Now, I'm not going to lie. It's not going to be nice and fun. I mean, it'll be fun for me, but it won't be nice for you.
So I wanted to do a little bit of experimenting here to see what would happen if we just let this guy talk. What would happen if we didn't throw the head at him? And this was absolutely horrifying. Was that not the most horrifying laugh of all time? Like, how creepy was that? Now, from there, you guys know that you're supposed to throw the head at him. And if you do that, you'll actually like stagger him a bit. And then you have the chance to knock him out and actually return him to the sheriff. And when you return him to the sheriff, you will have this conversation, which gives us some interesting details.
Found that fella you were looking for?
Which fella?
Put him on the floor and let's take a look at him. Fella been... Well, it ain't nothing nice. A lot of folk disappeared over the past few years. This sick son of a bitch, well, he ain't right in the head.
That's so.
Head over to the cellar of that broke-down shack on the road to the falls. See for yourself.
Okay, come on, Eve.
My name is Edmund. Edmund Lowry, Jr. And you'll remember that, my friend.
I'm sure I shall. Yeah, you are a frightening fella.
Well, I'll behave, sir. I'll behave as expected.
Well, you better. And I'll get you a lawyer, don't you worry about that. You get in that cell, calm as you be.
Get him! Get him off me!
You lunatic! What the hell is wrong with you?
So fun fact, I was actually trying to do another experiment, like what would happen if I didn't help the sheriff. And by not helping the sheriff, I apparently was disturbing the peace. So I'm not sure what I did wrong here, but I ended up getting in trouble. I completed the mission nonetheless, but either way, I thought that was pretty funny. Anyways, the important bit of detail here is his name, Edmund Lowry Jr. Now, if that name rings a bell for you, it's probably because you've played Grand Theft Auto 4. In Grand Theft Auto 4, there was another creepy character who actually was a serial killer, and his name was Edward Lowe. Do you guys see the connection there? Edward Lowe, Edmund Lowry, that is a direct reference right there, and Eddie Lowe is a serial killer in Grand Theft Auto 4. And the similarities between these serial killers seem to be insane. Eddie Lowe in GTA 4 was notorious for killing his victims late at night, which we clearly saw looked to be an activity of Edmund Lowry Jr. Eddie is also bisexual and very socially awkward, and we can assume based off of the letter his mother wrote that Edmund Lowry Jr. was the same way. She questioned the relationships that his son or her son was ultimately having. So is it possible that Eddie Lowe is a direct descendant of Edmund Lowry Jr.? I definitely think it's possible, and the similarities are just insane. So that is something you definitely might not have known about. And as I mentioned earlier, I tried like all the phrases I saw on the rocks as cheat codes, but I couldn't get them to work. And I'm not sure if I was doing something wrong. I'm pretty sure I was spelling everything correctly. So again, if you guys feel like you have a better idea of what those words mean or those phrases, be sure to let us know in the comments down below. But anyways, that right there is the dark and creepy secrets of the Red Dead Redemption 2 serial killer, Edmund Lowry Jr., that you might not have known about. I love mysteries like this, and I think this one is incredibly cool. Let me know your thoughts, opinions, and more on this, as always, in the comments down below. I'd love to hear from you guys down there. If you did go on to enjoy this video, though, a like rating would, of course, be awesome. And subscribe to my YouTube channel if you are new, or you like daily Red Dead Redemption 2 videos like this. With all the way, guys, like I said, thanks so much for watching. Take care, and I'll see you guys in the next video.